8 o'clock now. Thank you everyone for attending the seminar today, and particularly big thank you for Professor Yihong Ho from TALU, Texas A&M University, who is actually giving us these online seminars on Christmas Day. It's a big holiday in the States, and starting from today, I believe, until the 2nd of January. So big thank you there. Thank you for making the time. And I already introduced our linkage back in the old days, back when we were kids. So we'll drop that part for now. Dr. Yihong Ho is graduated from National Taiwan University from the Department of Electrical Engineering. And later he went to UIUC, University of Illinois, Champaign, for his doctoral, master and doctoral degrees in computer science. And because I'm not in the computer science field, but this seems very impressive. He's been receiving best paper awards in ACM, Mobile Hack, for twice. So, and from what I remember, he's really good at math, and he did major in mathematics in the university. So, with further ado, we will have Dr. Ho to give us a talk, and the title is Index Learning in Restless Bandits and its application for IoT. It's your floor now, Yihong.
Okay. And it is very nice seeing you over the screen this time. I hope next time we will be able to meet in person.
And this is an online seminar for the business of the conducting this. We will save our questions toward the end after Dr. Ho's talk.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Let us begin. Right, so today's talk topic is Index Learning in Restless Bandits and its application for IoT. So first of all, let me discuss what I mean by Restless Bandit. And before that, maybe I should discuss what I mean by this, what I call the traditional bandit problem. I will use Facebook as a motivating example on describing this problem. So in a standard bandit problem, we assume that there is a player, they are interacting with several arms. Okay, so arms is really just a technical jargon, right? In the real life sense, basically you can imagine that Facebook, it has a lot of clients, and clients, they want to place advertisement. And in each round, the player can play at most M arms. So in the context of Facebook, basically what I mean is that every time you log on to Facebook, Facebook can choose some advertisement to place within your news feed, but it cannot only place ads. You also need to place some other things. So let's say that Facebook is limited to display at most M advertisement on your news feed. And playing an arm will give the Facebook some independent random reward. So in this case, that basically means that when Facebook places the ad, you have a chance to click on that ad. And if you click on that ad, then Facebook makes some money. Okay, so this is a typical setting of a bandit problem. And this is also why it has become a very popular problem in the machine learning industry, because it is very relevant to advertisement placement. However, there is one important limitation in this description that comes from the last item, right? I say that playing an arm yields an independent random reward. So basically, typically the assumption is that whenever you place an advertisement, the user has a fixed chance of clicking on that advertisement. And therefore, if you are Facebook, then your goal is to figure out what advertisement the user will be most likely to click on it. Okay, and then you should just play this item for the user. This is what traditional bandit problem model the system. But in reality, the reward is not independent. It changes as the user changes. To illustrate how this happens, I will give you a real life example. And this is my personal experience. a couple of years back, I was going to take my family to a vacation in Florida. And I was thinking that actually we are going to visit a beach. If we are going to visit a beach, then maybe I should buy a waterproof camera. At that time, Facebook uses whatever magic it has, and it read my mind. So it showed me an advertisement of a GoPro, okay? And I look at the advertisement, and it's exactly what I want. So I immediately did some quick research and immediately bought that item. And in this case, this is really a win-win-win situation, right? I really need this GoPro, and I actually bought it. And both GoPro and Facebook made some money from me. But in the next few weeks, maybe because I just purchased the GoPro, okay, Facebook somehow believes that I am very, very interested in GoPro advertisement. So in the next couple of weeks, every time I log on to Facebook, Facebook will show me pages after pages of GoPro advertisement, to a point where I got kind of annoyed. I mean, I just purchased a GoPro. What do you want to achieve by showing me more GoPro advertisement? So of course, I did not buy a second GoPro. And in the eye of Facebook, it was actually a lot of missed opportunity for it, because it displayed advertisement they are bound to not being useful for me. Okay, so you can see that in this story, it is still the same product. It is still the same advertisement, but the reward it generates changes. Why? Because I changed. The state of me changed. I went from somebody needing a GoPro to somebody that already have a GoPro, okay? So the reality is that whenever we place an advertisement, we also need to consider the state of that advertisement. And we need to understand that the state of an ad may change based on our actions. People model this problem as a restless bandit problem. In this problem, we assume that there are several arms, but each arm has an individual state. And at each run, the player is going to observe the state of each arm. And based on the state of arms, you're going to pick some arms to play. And these arms are going to generate their reward based on whether they are played or not, and also based on their current states. Moreover, their states may change based on whether it's being played or not. Our goal is to figure out a way to play these arms so that we can maximize our total reward. So now this talk is not about Facebook. This talk is about IoT. So how is the problem relevant to IoT? Actually, a lot of problems are very related to, in IoT, are very related to this restless bandit problem. I will just give you two examples. In the first example, let's consider the problem of gathering information from sensors. So you can imagine that we are doing remote sensing. So we put a lot of sensors out there, and this sensor is going to monitor some situation, right? Maybe some sensors are monitoring temperature, some sensors may be monitoring humidity, and some sensors may be monitoring wildlife activity, etc. Okay? And now, what do we want from these sensors? We want their information, right? But we cannot get their information immediately. Rather, what we need to do is that we need to send a message to this sensor and ask that sensor to send information back to us, right? So now we are a controller, okay? We are gathering this information from all these sensors, and because we want to know the current situation of the entire system. In this case, how do we measure the performance of each sensor? Intuitively, what we want is that we want to know what is happening at the location of that particular sensor. To know the information, we want to know the most recent information, right? Like if I get a reading from a sensor, but that reading was 5 days ago, then this reading is not very useful. A lot of things can change in 5 days, so it may not be able to give me the current situation. On the other hand, if I just get a piece of information from a sensor 3 seconds ago, then I can reasonably believe that the information I have reasonably accurately reflect what is currently happening in that particular location. So people propose a metric called age of information to measure how old our information is. In a nutshell, age of information is basically defined as our current time minus the time of the most recent update from this sensor. So today in Taiwan is the 26th, right? So if you look at the time stamp of your most recent reading, and it says it's 24th, today is 26th, then that means that this piece of information is 2 days old. In this case, I will say that your age of information is 2 days. Okay, so in this case, we can model the state of an arm based on its current age of information, its current channel quality, etc., etc. And given the information of each arm, I only have a finite wireless resource. So maybe I have 1,000 sensors, but I can only gather information from 10 of them. So I will, among these 1,000 sensors, I will choose 10 of them and send information to their sensor, ask them to send an update to me. Okay, so in this case, I can model the problem like this. And in this case, I want my age of information to be as small as possible. So I can simply define the reward of a sensor as -1 times its current age of information. We can look at another case, right? The first case, I'm looking at sensing. The next case, I can look at control, right? I get all this information from sensors. Why do I need this information? Because I want to control something. Okay, so in the second case, let's consider control. So in this case, I'm imagining that I'm a controller and I'm controlling a bunch of robots. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to broadcast some control commands to some groups of robots. So maybe I will send a command to some of the robots saying that all of you, please take a particular action at 1 p.m. today. Okay. Then in this case, my command has a strict deadline, right? Because this is a command that is going to be taken at 1 p.m. If I send this command to a robot at 2 p.m., then the command is not useful at all. So I need to deliver the command before 1 p.m. So I will say that 1 p.m. is the deadline of this particular command. If I fail to deliver the command before 1 p.m., then the command is no longer useful. So in this case, each command is an arm. And what is the state of the command? It will depend on how much time do I have to transmit this command, right? The time until the deadline expires. It also depends on which robots have already received the commands and which robots have not received the command yet, okay? I may have like 1,000 commands to send, but at any given point of time, I may only be able to transmit 10 commands. So I'm going to look at the state of all my 1,000 commands. Based on their state, I'm going to pick 10 of them and transmit right now. And because I want to make sure that I deliver the commands on time, so the reward of an arm, I can define it as the number of robots I can successfully deliver on time, or maybe you can just look at the flip of it. The reward of an arm can be defined -1 times deadline violations. And the list goes on and on. So you can see that in many applications in IoT, we can really model them as a restless bandit problem. So now we want to solve the problem of restless bandit. Unfortunately, it has been proven to be very hard to solve. Why so? Maybe let's consider some of the intuitive approach. Probably one intuitive approach is that we can think about this myopic policy. That is, at each run, we are going to look at the state of all arms, and then we are going to pick the arm that can give us the highest reward right now. Unfortunately, this is not an optimal solution, because when we are taking an action, not only that we are getting a reward, but we are also changing the state of the arm. And if we are only looking at the reward we get today, then what we may end up doing is that we might drive the system into a very, very bad state tomorrow. Then in tomorrow, we don't have any good choice. And in tomorrow, we will suffer from low reward. So myopy decision is not optimal. And for those of you that have expertise in control theory, you will know that you potentially you can model the problem as a Markov decision process, an MDP. So basically, you are looking at that this system has a state, and you are deciding that based on the state, what is the optimal action to take. But the problem is that the state space will increase very fast. Because think about it, what is the state of the system? The state of the system is basically the state of each individual arms. So if I have 1,000 arms, then the state of the system will be the state of the first arm, the state of the second arm, the state of the third arm, so on and so forth until the state of arm number 1,000. So it's a very high dimensional space and it is intractable to solve. So in fact, this has been proved to be P space hard to solve. So we know that this problem is very hard to solve, but we still need to solve it. What can we do? So people have been looking at heuristics that are able to not optimally solve the problem, but at least being able to get some reasonably good performance. One particular policy has been very successful is called index policy. The basic idea of index policy is that we are going to define an index value of each state. Now, importantly is that the index of an arm only depends on its own state. It doesn't depend on the state of all other arms. Therefore, we avoid the high dimensionality problem because I'm only looking at an arm, right? So I completely ignore the other 999 arms. So I'm only going to look at this arm and the index only depends on the state of that arm only. And in each round, what I'm going to do is I'm going to calculate the index value of each individual arm. And then I'm going to sort all arms by their indexes. I'm going to pick the arms with the highest index to play. So intuitively, the index will reflect how important it is to play the arm right now. Okay, and then I'm going to pick the M arms that are most important right now to play. And of course, the performance of index policy really depends on how we define the index. And one particular index has been very popular and very successful is called Hueytel index. And it has been proved to be optimal or near optimal in many, many settings. So the major goal of this talk is that I want to figure out a way to teach machines to learn Hueytel index. But it turns out that learning Hueytel index is not easy. The reason is that Hueytel index is an artificial construct. It's not something you can directly observe or measure. Also, usually it is very difficult to calculate the Hueytel index. In fact, in the domain of IoT applications, even though there are many, many problems that are relevant to the restless bandit problem, we only know the Hueytel index of a few special cases. For most problems we have, we know nothing about their Hueytel index. And frankly, if we already know the Hueytel index, then we don't need machines to tell us how to find the Hueytel index. We just use it already, right? So the whole point is that we need to teach machine to learn something that we ourselves have no idea what it is. How can we do that? So when I'm thinking about this problem, I recall a conversation I had with my kid. When my son was very, very little, he liked to ask a lot of questions. So one day he will ask me, "Hey daddy, what is an elephant?" This is a very easy question to answer. We have a lot of picture books in our house. So I take out animal books. I show him a couple of pictures of elephants. Now he knows what an elephant is. The next day he asked me, "Hey daddy, what is an ambulance?" It is also a very easy question to answer. I simply Google ambulance and show him a couple of pictures of ambulance. Now he knows what an ambulance is. And if you think about it, the traditional AI the AI is able to do vision processing. The AI is able to tell whether they're cutting in a picture or not. It's basically being trained this way, right? How do I teach an AI to tell the difference between a cat and a dog? Very easy. I gather a million picture of a cat. I gather another million picture of dogs. I feed these 2 million pictures into a deep neural network. If I design my algorithm right, the deep neural network will automatically learn how to distinguish between cats and dogs. But then one day my son asked me, "Hey, daddy, every day you say that you love me. So what is love?" Well, this is a great question, right? People way smarter than me have tried and failed, by the way, to answer this question. So what did I say? This is what I told him. I told him that because I love you, I enjoy playing with you and reading stories with you. So what was I doing here? Was I telling him the definition of love? Of course not. Was I giving him examples of love? Not really. What I was really doing here is that I was telling him properties of love. I'm telling him that if you have love, these are the behaviors you will exhibit. So when I saw of this story, I realized that I cannot teach a machine using Whittle index definition. It is not very useful. I cannot teach machines using examples of Whittle index because I don't know the Whittle index. But what I can do is that I can teach a machine using Whittle index properties. Okay, so from now on, I'm going to discuss an important property of Whittle index and how we can learn Whittle index using their property. By the way, some of you may be wondering that how come I haven't told you what Whittle index is. I do it on purpose because you see, I did not let my machine know the definition of Whittle index, and therefore I'm not going to let you know what the definition of Whittle index is. I'm going to teach you Whittle index the same way I teach my machine, using the property of Whittle index. And I also mentioned that when defining Whittle index, we only need to look at the stack of one single arm. We can ignore all other arms. So from now on, let us zoom in and focus on only one arm. So now we have already zoomed in and now we are only looking at one arm only. And I want you to look at this arm and try to imagine a different problem. In this case, we have only one arm. So we can play the arm whenever we like. But there comes with a catch. I'm going to assume that every time you play this arm, you need to pay a price. You need to pay lambda dollars in order to play this arm. So in each round, you are the player. What you are going to do is this. You are going to look at the state of that arm. I denote it by S of T. And then you are going to decide whether you want to play the arm or not. So you are going to choose the value of AT. If AT equal to 1, that means you are going to play the arm. AT equal to 0 means that you are not going to play the arm in this round, and you move to the next round. And then, depending on the state and your action, you are going to receive a reward, RT. And if you play the arm, you need to pay lambda dollars. So if AT is 1, you need to pay lambda. If AT is 0, you need to pay 0. So you pay an activation cost of lambda times AT, and the state of the arm will change. Your goal is that you want to find a strategy to decide on whether to play the arm or not, so that you can maximize your net reward, right? What is net reward? This is the reward you get minus the price you pay, and then we sum it over time, okay? So the long-term total net reward you can get. Okay, so now let me try to draw this problem in a figure. Okay, so in this case, you are the player. You are interacting with this arm. At the beginning of each round, you are going to look at the state. You are going to make a decision on whether to play it or not. And then you give the decision to the arm. The arm is going to give you a net reward, RT minus lambda times AT. It will also give you the state in the next round. So there will be S of T plus one. And then we move on to T plus one, you make the same decision again, and then we go to T plus two, so on and so forth. You are the player, want to find a strategy to maximize your long-term total net reward. So what is your optimal strategy? It turns out that your optimal strategy is very relevant to Whittle index. In fact, this is your strategy. You should choose AT to be one if and only if the Whittle index of this state is larger than lambda. Let me draw this in picture. So now what I'm saying is that in order to get the best reward, what you should be doing is that you look at the state, you calculate the Whittle index of this state. Let me call it F of ST. And then you get the Whittle index, you are going to pass it through a state function. You are going to compare it with lambda. If this value is larger than lambda, you choose AT to be 1. If this value is smaller than lambda, you choose AT to be 0. As it turns out, this is the optimal strategy to maximize your total net reward. Now, in reinforcement learning jargon, what they like to say is that the arm is the environment. This is a problem you want to solve. And this player, they call it the agent, right? So this is a policy you want to employ so that you can solve this environment. And you pass in, further calculating the Whittle index and then compare the Whittle index with lambda to get AT. This is the optimal solution to this particular environment. Now, I'm going to change the figure a little bit, like this. You can see that I didn't really change the figure all that much. All I did is I changed the boundary between the environment and the agent. Now I say that this state function and this arm together, they form the environment. They are the problems that we want to solve. And here I'm comparing my index with lambda. So this problem depends on lambda. So I call this problem environment of lambda. So what environment lambda does is that it takes a real number as an input. And what it does is that you will first compare this real number with lambda. If it's larger than lambda, this is 1. If otherwise it's 0, and then it will feed this value to this arm to generate the next state and the net reward. You are the agent. You want to pick a real number to be fed into this environment of lambda. As what we have discussed so far, you can easily see that if you want to get the optimal solution for this environment of lambda, then your optimal solution is this box, the Whittle index. So given every state, you just output the Whittle index, you just send the Whittle index of that state into the environment of lambda. If you do it every time, then you are going to maximize your total net reward. So when I draw this figure this way, one thing you can see is that Whittle index is not just an index. It is actually the best agent policy for environment of lambda. And not just for one environment, it is for any lambda. This is the optimal strategy. And this is a fundamental property I'm going to leverage in order to design a machine learning algorithm to learn Whittle index. And when I managed to draw this picture, I feel very hopeful, right? So I feel that, okay, so now this Whittle index is just the optimal policy for environment of lambda. Finding an optimal strategy for an environment, this is the strength of all these reinforcement learning algorithms. So it seems like we can easily design a reinforcement learning algorithm and build a neural network that predicts the Whittle index. Unfortunately, I got stuck in almost immediately. Why? The challenge comes from the last part of the last sentence. I say that Whittle index is not just an index. It is a base agent policy for environment of lambda. And not just for one lambda, it needs to hold for all lambda. This is the part that is giving me trouble because most reinforcement algorithms, what they are good at is that they are very good at figuring out the optimal strategy for one single environment. But right now, I don't want to optimize just one environment. I want to optimize for all possible environments, going from lambda equal to minus infinity to plus infinity. I actually need to optimize infinite many different environments all at once. And that's the challenge, okay? So I immediately got stuck. So I was thinking that, okay, I cannot come up with the algorithm immediately, but let's at least figure out how do I evaluate a solution, right? So now let's imagine that I'm already given a neural network that can predict Whittle index. Am I able to evaluate whether it's a good neural network or not? So I'm going to say that I'm given a neural network mu, phi, okay? And mu phi of S is the predicted Whittle index of state S. So suppose this is a real Whittle index. What it says is that if I apply this to environment of lambda, then I'm going to choose AT to be 1 if this index is larger than lambda. If this index is smaller than lambda, I will choose AT to be 0. Okay, and based on that, I can define this Q function. Okay, this Q function basically says that this is a long-term average reward I can get if my activation cost is lambda. Right now, my state is S, right? When t equal to 1, my state is S. When t equal to 1, let's say I take action A, but I also know that starting from t equal to 2, I'm going to follow this index policy. Okay, starting from t equal to 2, my action will be 1 if mu phi of S is larger than lambda. Otherwise, it will be 0. Okay, so this is what reinforcement learning people call the Q function. Okay, so the Q function is a long-term average reward I can get if starting from t equal to 2, I follow this particular index policy. So I'm going to define my objective function as the summation of all possible Q value. What are all possible Q value? I need to look at all possible state. So I have a summation S here. I need to look at all possible lambda here. So I'm going to do an integral of lambda. Lambda going from minus m to plus m. M is just a huge number so that I'm confident that it covers the all possibilities of Whittle index. Okay, so now if you look at this, we know that if we want to maximize long-term average reward, what we should be doing is that we should replace this index to be my Whittle index. So if I really find the Whittle index right here, then I make the whole thing as large as possible, right? So if in order to find the Whittle index, what I can do is that I can just try to maximize K phi. If I'm able to maximize K phi, then I'm able to find Whittle index. So now I want to maximize this objective function K phi. And most machine learning techniques, they basically rely on what you learned in calculus 101, the gradient method. The idea is that initially you just pick a random point, okay? And then you are going to look at the gradient around that point, right? So suppose you want to maximize a one-dimensional curve, okay? So now you are looking at what that point, in one-dimensional case, gradient becomes derivative, right? So you are going to look at the derivative of that point. If the derivative at that point is increasing, that means that when you move to the right-hand side, the function will increase. The function is an increasing function. So the derivative is positive, means the function is increasing. So in this case, you will move to the right-hand side by a little, so that the function becomes larger. But if the derivative is decreasing, that means that the function is a decreasing function. In this case, if you want to make the function larger, you should move on to the left-hand side, okay? So the same idea here. You randomly choose a point. You find the gradient of that point. The gradient basically points towards the direction where the function will increase. And then you will just move towards that direction and update your phi. You keep repeating that. And then when the phi converges, you will be end up going to a local maximal point. Okay, so right now we want to apply the gradient method. But there is one problem. What is the gradient of this function k? As it turns out, it doesn't seem to be easy. Because if you look at the k function right here, it looks kind of complicated. Moreover, first of all, you have this part. You are comparing this mu phi to lambda. If it's larger than lambda, it's 1. If it's smaller than lambda, it's 0. This is not even a continuous function, not to mention differentiable, right? Also, you have an ugly integral here. So it seems that it is hard to find the gradient. But as it turns out, we figure out that actually it is very easy. There is an easy expression for the gradient. So we prove that the gradient of k is as simple as this equation. Now, there are many terms in this equation. You don't need to worry about that. But the first thing I want you to notice is that there is no integral in this equation. We get rid of that integral. Now, let us look at this equation term by term. The first term is the number of states. It is just a constant, so you can ignore it. The second one is a q function when a is 1 and a q function when a is 0. So we need to know the q function. In reality, of course, we don't know the q function. So what we need is that we need to train another neural network that can look at the empirical behavior and learn this q function. Finally, the last term, this is a gradient of the neural network itself. So this is something that can be easily be done by doing a simple backward propagation. So we use this simple gradient expression to develop our policy called DeepTop, Deep Threshold Optimal Policy. And here is the outline of our algorithm design. What we are going to do is that we are going to initialize an actor network and a critic network for each arm. Basically, what we want is that the actor network will give us the whittle index. So you will maximize the objective function k. And the critic network is going to learn the function q. So we want the critic network theta to output the same value of q eventually. And in each step, we are going just to follow the index policy with high probability. But in order to explore all possibilities, occasionally we also just randomly pick some arm to activate and see how it behaves. And we are going to store all the results we observe in the real life in a memory. And in each step, we are going to get some result from the memory, and we are going to use it to train two things. First of all, we are going to use it to estimate whether the value of theta and the value of q are the same. Right? Remember that we want theta to be as close to q as possible. So we are just going to look at theta minus q squared. And we are going to update theta to make this thing as small as possible. And then we are also going to use this sample to update our phi network so that we can and we are just going to estimate the gradient of k, and we use that gradient to update our actor network. Okay, so this is the algorithm design. Now I am going to show you some simulation results. So we look at the literature and we try to find IoT applications where there are papers out there showing that we already know the whittle index for these particular IoT applications. There are not many papers that have figured out whittle index. As I mentioned, right, we human beings know very, very little about whittle index. So we only find three applications where we human beings know the whittle index. One paper is that it tried to minimize the total age of information in a system. It considered an unreliable wireless channel. By unreliable, I mean that whenever I send data to a sensor, there is a certain probability that the transmission will be successful, and there is a certain probability that the transmission is not successful. Okay. The second case, I consider AOI minimization, but in this case, I consider something called the on-off channel. On-off channel basically considers that the channel is either on or off. If the channel is on, that means that the sensor is currently have a good connection with me. So whatever I transmit to the sensor will receive it, and vice versa. If the sensor is going to send me a piece of information, I will be able to receive it. But if the channel is off, that means the connection is very bad right now. Okay, maybe the sensor is very far away from me, so signal is very weak. Or maybe there are some other jammers that create a lot of noise over there, and therefore I'm not able to get the information from the sensor. And in this system, we basically assume that at the beginning, we have a lot of sensors. Each sensor has a channel. We are able to know which sensor has an on channel and which sensor has an off channel. Based on this information, we are going to pick some sensor to transmit. Our goal is to minimize total AOI. In the third example, we are going to look at that. I have a bunch of robots, and I'm going to broadcast some real-time control message to these robots. Okay, and I want to make sure that most of my commands are delivered on time. For these three problems, there are papers out there that show that the Whittle index follows a particular equation. So we are just going to use these papers. Okay, and here are our similar results. The orange line is the Whittle index coming from these papers. And the blue line is what we achieve by running our deep top algorithm. And you can see that in all situations, the blue line converts to the orange line rather quickly, meaning that very fast, our deep top algorithm indeed learns the Whittle index, and therefore it behaves exactly the same way as how the Whittle index policy would behave. Okay, so for these three problems where we already know the Whittle index, we are able to recover the Whittle index by running the deep top algorithm. But I will tell myself that if all we can do is to rediscover some pieces that other people have already discovered, then it's no fun. Let's try to do something that nobody else has done before. So we are going to look at a problem where we human beings have no idea what the Whittle index is. In this case, I consider the problem of AOI minimization, but I consider a more complicated channel model called the Gilbert ADA channel. I will not get into detail right now, but basically Gilbert ADA channel considers a case where there are some memory for the channel. So if your channel is good right now, then most likely your channel will still be good in the next second. If your channel is bad right now, then most likely in the next second, your channel will still be bad. Okay, so this is a more tricky channel to analyze, and therefore we do not know what the Whittle index for this problem is yet. Okay, so we are going to compare with some existing work. We human beings don't really know the Whittle index, so we find that maybe the closest thing we have is that somebody has figured out the Whittle index when the channel is IID. Okay, I say that this is probably close enough. So let's you compare against this policy. I will call it Whittle. Meanwhile, we have another recent paper that have taken a very different approach, not an index policy approach, but we also solve this different problem. This problem using a different approach, so it's called VWD. Okay, this is our simulation result. We consider the case where we have we have either 5 clients or 10 clients or 20 clients. Okay, and you can see that in all cases, the blue line is my deep top. The deep top gradually converts to the red line. The red line is a theoretically optimal performance. When there are a large number of clients, it converts slower. That's for sure. If you have more clients, then it is harder to learn the system. But also, I want to point out that you can see that for these two figures, very quickly the blue line becomes better than the black line. The black line is the Whittle index, assuming the channel is IID. Okay, so this is the closest thing we human beings have. So in other words, in a few thousand of steps, my deep top is able to learn a better index than the best approximations we human beings have. Okay, so we are able to beat the best approximation. So you can see that deep top indeed is very powerful in quickly learning the Whittle index of a restless bandit problem, which have a lot of applications to IoT. Okay, now I want to switch the topic a little bit. Now, let's go back and see what I have done so far, okay? What I set out to do is that I want to design a machine learning algorithm that can learn the Whittle index. the fundamental property I use is that I realize that Quito index is an optimal threshold policy, right? Because what you are doing is that you are looking at the Quito index, you are going to compare your Quito index with lambda, right? So Quito index like the threshold. This is the highest lambda you are willing to pay. If lambda is higher than your Quito index, you will choose A equal to zero. If lambda is lower than your Quito index, then you are going to choose A equal to one. And it turns out that this is optimal policy. Okay, so Quito index is basically a threshold policy when you look at this way. And we basically use this insight to design a machine learning algorithm called DeepTop to learn Quito index. But notice that Quito index is a threshold policy, not vice versa, right? Not all threshold policies are Quito index policy. There exist many other threshold policies that are not Quito index. So can we try to generalize DeepTop to solve any threshold policy? Before I describe the algorithm, I probably need to describe what I mean by threshold policy. And I think it's best described by example. So for example, you can consider a smart home server. The smart home server will decide whether to turn on the AC or not. And what will it do? Basically what it does is it will set a threshold for temperature. It will say that I will turn on the AC if the temperature inside the house exceeds this particular threshold. Now, what is this threshold? Okay. For typical AC system, you need to manually set the threshold, okay? But right now I'm talking about a smart AC. It doesn't require human involvement, right? It can learn the threshold on its own. So this threshold will be determined by a bunch of factors, like whether there are people in the house, right? So there's an immediately factor. If there are no one in the house, then you can set the threshold higher. You don't want to turn on the AC in an empty house all the time. It may also depend on the time of the day, right? If it's already 5 p.m., maybe the house is still hot, but we know that it is going to cool down very fast. So we don't need to set the threshold to be very low, okay? It may also depend on the electricity price, right? If the electricity price is very high, then you want to set the threshold higher. You don't want to turn on the AC. But if the electricity price is very low, then you can prioritize personal comfort and you can set the temperature to be lower. A smart home server will be able to adjust this threshold based on whether there are people in the house, based on time of the day, based on electricity price, etc. Another example is that you can look at this assisted driving. Now, nowadays, a lot of cars have this equipment, right? So if you drive a newer car on the highway, you will notice that you can turn on assist driving, and what your car will do is that you will try to follow the car in front of you, okay? And if you get too close to a car in front of you, then your car will automatically apply the brake and slow down. So what is your car doing? Basically, it's also a threshold policy. What it says is that the assist driving car, I will take the brake if the distance to the car in front of me is below a certain threshold. How do we decide that threshold? Well, most likely, that threshold will be determined by your speed and the speed of the car in front of you, and also maybe some other factors. Using all these factors, the assisted driving car will set a threshold of distance. If the distance to the car in front of you is below that threshold, it will apply the brake. Okay, so you can see that in many real-life problems, indeed, the optimal control policy can be reduced to a threshold policy. You either compare the room temperature to your threshold to determine whether to turn on the AC or not, or you compare the distance to the car in front of you against the threshold to decide whether you want to apply the brake or not. Now, let me formally define the problem. Okay, so I'm going to consider the following Markov decision process, and I will use the smart AC as an example. Now, the process has a state, but the state has two components. One, I call it a discrete vector state. There will be the time of the day, whether there are people in the house or not, and the electricity price, etc. And another component is called a scalar state. indicate it will be the room temperature. A controller will look at all the state, right, including the vector state and the scalar state. And then you can apply a binary action, A equals 0 or 1. 0 means turn off the AC, 1 means turn on the AC. And then the state of the system will change. In this case, what the threshold policy does is that it based on the vector state, right? Based on whether there are people in the house, based on the time of the day, based on electricity price, you will set a threshold for a scalar state. So you will set a threshold called mu of Vt. At any point of time, we are going to compare this threshold against the scalar state, the room temperature, okay? If the threshold the determined by the function mu is larger than lambda, then we will choose AT to be 1. Otherwise, we will choose AT to be 0, okay? So this is what I mean by a threshold policy. By this description, you can see that there are indeed a huge similarity to what I just described to the restless bandit problem. So we are going to use a similar way of evaluating the function, the policy. We can define the Q function, the action value function, as suppose right now this is the scalar state, the room temperature is lambda, the vector state, whether there are people in the house, time of the day, etc., is V, and the action A is the action we take right now. And starting from the next slot, we are going to use the threshold policy given by the function mu, okay? And we can define this as the Q function, and we want to maximize this K function. This is basically the summation of V and integral of lambda for this Q function, okay? And when I say that I want to find the optimal threshold policy, I basically mean that I want to find a threshold function mu so that I can maximize the function k of mu. Because the formulation is so similar to the restless bandit problem, I think you can be easily convinced that my deep tau algorithm can be easily modified to solve this particular problem. And we indeed designed such an algorithm, and we evaluate on three different problems. I will not get into detail, so I will just mention that one problem try to decide whether to charge an electric vehicle or not. The second problem is about inventory management, and the third problem is about make-to-stock production. Okay, again, I will not get into the detail of these three problems, but one thing I want to mention is that for these simulations, I have two purposes. Number one is, of course, I want to convince you that my algorithm works well. But also, I have a second goal, which is probably even more important. That is, I want to convince you that indeed, a lot of problems are threshold policies. In order to do that, what I do is that I did not make up any of these problems. For all these problems, I really dig the literature, and I find some papers from the literature, and I evaluate these problems. Okay, so here are the simulation results, and you can see that for all three cases, deep tau indeed achieves the optimal performance against all other policies. For one of the problems, the EV charging problem, there's a paper out there that have found the optimal threshold. They call it a deadline index policy, and you can see that my deep tau is basically identical to the deadline index policy, meaning that my deep tau algorithm is able to learn the optimal threshold policy. Okay, and we also evaluate other reinforcement learning algorithms, and all of them perform poorly. Now, let me conclude. Okay, we studied the problem of learning Whittle index for a restless bandit problem, and I have shown you that restless bandit problem have a lot of application in IoT. And the key insight is that Whittle index is not just an index. It is actually an optimal threshold policy. And using this key insight, we develop a deep tau to learn Whittle index. We also show that it can be easily extended to address other type of threshold policy. And this is all I have, and thank you.
Thank you, Yihong. It's very impressive work. I learned a lot of things. I'm sure everyone here does as well. Maybe 10 minutes for some quick questions for Dr. Ho. We're having the, you wanna go for it, David?
Okay, so I got the first question. I'm interested about the, because you are using the reinforcement learning to to solve this problem, but I'm interested about how you can prove that the method you are using can be a long-term success. It's not a very short-term short-term successful kind of things, because I think one of the interesting topics of the deep learning is that some reinforcement learning results only have the successful in a very short time range. Yeah, so you only prove that with the results that you have, or you can prove it by the method that you are using, like the reward function or some kind of things. Yeah.
Yeah. May I add it to it? I think resonate to David's question here. One of the slides you have, is comparing three applications for IoT. Mm-hmm. And your reward, we saw your prediction for Weitel index going up and down. So when do you know when you actually achieve to that optimal learned method?
Okay, so. I think maybe these are separate questions. For David's question, it's really like you are thinking like very, very long term on whether this work can be generalized, right?
Yeah.
I will tell you why I'm interested in this study to begin with, right? My background is on wireless scheduling, right? So I first tried to do like wireless scheduling for teleconference, like what we are doing right now. Later on, people start to study application like Netflix, okay? And then people start to consider quality of the experience. So I also did a little bit studying on how to design a network scheduling policy to optimize QoE. Recently, people are interested in remote sensing, so people are interested in AI. So I also did some study on how to design a network scheduling policy for better AI, right? I enjoy all this work, but at some point, I also think that this is not really sustainable because every week there's a new application coming up. Yeah, if I kind of feel like I'm always playing the catch up, right? Every week there comes a new application. The new application has some behavior I've not think about before, and therefore all the algorithms I designed in the past decade are not going to work. So I need to design a new algorithm, right? So this is not really sustainable. And then what draws me into the Weitel index? Because Weitel index is general. It can be applied to virtually all restless bandit problem, right? And for any wireless scheduling problem, fundamentally, what you have is that you have a bunch of wireless client. Each client has a state. What that state means depends on your application, right? If you are running a teleconference, the state may be this and that. If you are running Netflix, the state may be some other things. If you are running remote sensing, the state may be some other things. I don't care. But no matter what, you have a state, you have a reward. And we try to schedule the system so that we can maximize the total performance. So I kind of feel that Weitel index, in a sense, right? I'm probably exaggerating a little bit, but Weitel index kind of feel like this is a one-size-fits-all solution. Unfortunately, it is so hard to solve. We don't know how to calculate Weitel index. And that's why I'm interested in designing algorithms that can automatically learn Weitel index. So to answer David's question, I would say that I do believe for most wireless scheduling problems, Weitel index will be useful. As long as the Weitel index is useful, you will be able to apply my algorithm to get the optimal result. Now, there are always room for improvement, right? There will be some other factor we can try to extend. But the fundamental insight that is we try to learn Weitel index, I believe that is a very general thing, at least in the context of scheduling for IoT.
Okay.
And now for this problem, that is a much harder question to answer, right? So basically you are asking that, when do I know I can stop, right? That I really don't know. Okay, so that is a very interesting question, and I think that is already a question in the reinforcement learning, or something we may want to consider in the future. So that is a great question, but unfortunately I don't have an answer. Yeah, so I would say that that's a great question. Unfortunately, I don't have an answer, because what you are fundamentally asking is that, right, I can even generalize it. Fundamentally, that if we are running reinforcement learning, how long do we need to run? When do we know that we can stop already? That I don't have a good answer, right? Some of very naive solution would be that you can look at the performance of the system. If it start improving over several runs, then you can stop, okay? But I don't have a good answer, and I think it is a great question that deserves more thinking.
Thank you. Any other questions here in the classroom? Or any other questions online? Anyone with us?
I have a question.
Yeah, sure, go for it.
So in your model, the threshold function is in the problem or in the environment?
Can you repeat that?
So in your model, you mentioned the threshold function is in the problem or in the environment, right?
Okay, yes.
So, yes.
Right, so what I'm saying is that you can really look at the Hoyle index as a threshold, right? Because fundamentally, you are going to compare it against lambda. Okay, and when you draw the picture like this way, right? Then Hoyle index is a threshold. What the environment does is that you will first take this threshold into here, compare it with lambda, and then make the decision.
So why is a good idea to make it into binary information rather than like transition possibility?
Okay, right. So. Why is it a good idea? Because, right, so it comes from here, right? So the train of thought is that if I want to optimize this problem, it turns out that my solution is a threshold policy, right? That is, I look at Hoyle index compared to lambda. And it can be, and this is from the Hoyle index definition, this is a direct result, right? That is, this policy is the optimal policy. Okay, so you can just take it as a definition of Hoyle index, okay? So it's not that why it is a good idea, but rather Hoyle index is defined this way. It defined as the optimal solution to this environment. Do you understand your question?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, any other questions here? I think we will learn one thing today, Yvonne. In order to be successful in career, you have to establish a family and have a kids asking a lot of questions. I think.
Yeah. Indeed.
Yeah. Okay. So since we don't have more questions, we would like to thank you, big thank you for spending time with us on Christmas Day, and we'll be. Yeah, we'll be in touch and maybe have you back shortly.
Sure, yeah. Sure. I would love to. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye bye for now. Thank you.